All right, folks, we're going to make a start. So thank you very much. Kia ora whānau, te aloha lava, and warm greetings. Congratulations and welcome to the Part 2 Orientation Day 2017. Just before I do start, on behalf of our colleagues in the Faculty of Law, our staff at the back, we'd like to extend a huge congratulations. It's no easy feat to get in, but I can say you guys have actually made it. Congratulations. No need to go and flaunt your 131 book anymore. You've actually made it. Like I see the rest of you flaunting it. This is not Lala. This is actually Moonlight. You guys did get the award to actually get in. So yeah, we'd like to extend a huge congratulations, testament to your hard work, and we must acknowledge the support of your families as well as the various support systems that have helped you get here. I'm your Master of Ceremony, Harry, and I'll be facilitating today's wonderful, session. This next 3 hours might be 3 hours of your life you can't get back, but can I just encourage you, please pay attention. In front of you is a survival pack. I didn't get a survival pack, which probably explains why it takes me 10 years to do a four-year degree. In there is a bottle, a water bottle, because we're actually going into the wilderness, a muesli bar, as well as various survival guides put together by the Student Law Centre, as well as the various student associations. Can I just also say, we want to extend a huge thank you to you for choosing our faculty. Thank you for studying with us, and without you guys, obviously, there wouldn't be me, at least. I'm not on their salary bracket, but at least there wouldn't be me. So the more fees you guys get, thank you very much, the more pays that I get. I'll just quickly run through our program, and then I'll pass it over to our Professor, our Deputy Dean, Professor Susan Watts, to extend a formal welcome. But today's program, we're just going to hear from faculty. Then we'll also hear from Stephen Pink, who will go through the Part 2 structure, because we send lengthy emails that none of you guys read, but he will break it down for us so we can all understand. Then we'll hear from our course directors for the various different Part 2 courses, and then we'll also follow by study techniques with Professor Warren Swain, and then we'll also have a little break. There's an introductory lecture for Law 298, which is a compulsory legal research and writing course, and then we'll hear from our two representatives from the Careers Development Service, Kylie Ryan, who will be doing well, as well as our careers representative, Shannon Rain. We'll also be hearing from students, the student services, and then we'll be capping it off with a good old-fashioned barbecue. All right, folks, so it gives me great pleasure to introduce our first speaker, so if you can just please join me in welcoming Professor Susan Watts.
The first thing I wanted to do was add the congratulations of everyone here to all of you. It's actually quite some achievement, as you know, to get into Auckland Law School. The places are really sought after, and already everyone in this room has achieved something very significant by meeting the entry standards and being here. So we're very glad that you're here and very pleased, as Harry said, that you've chosen us. I can remember actually sitting where you all are sitting in 1982 when I was a new student at Auckland Law School. And someone standing up the front, and that person standing up the front said to all of us in this room, our future High Court and Supreme Court judges, future partners in major law firms, and looking, and we all looked around the room at each other and thought, really, I wonder who amongst all the people here that will be. And it turned out, I can tell you now, it turned out to be true. So there are people from my cohort who are judges, who are senior partners in law firms, but also Simon Dallow, who's reads the news on TV1. There's cabinet ministers who are in the same cohort, and currently there are cabinet ministers who went to Auckland Law School. So many of you will go on to take roles in life, major roles in law firms, but also generally in other fields. Many of you will go into business or work for not-for-profits, but many of you will take on leadership roles. And one of the things that gets fed back to us from people who have studied law at Auckland Law School is that even if many of them practice law, but for those who don't, the extent to which the skills and the way of thinking that they learnt at law school carries them forward into many other careers and other enterprises and parts of life. So I think you'll find that you some subjects at university you enjoy, but you sometimes come out and think, well, actually, I enjoyed this. I learnt about this subject, but I didn't learn how to do something different. But what you'll get from your law degree, and particularly, which I'll talk about in a minute from part two, is that you'll learn skills that you won't learn from any other part of the university and which you wouldn't otherwise acquire. And that's the skills of legal thinking and legal reasoning. So this next period while you're at law school, part two, will be the period when you really learn the skills of the trade, how to think and be like a lawyer. I want to talk to you a little bit about the people who will be talking to you today. I first want to introduce Stephen Pink, who will be speaking to you after me. Now, Stephen Pink is sort of the engine of the law school. He's the person who keeps things running. He's been connected with the law school since 1984, and it's hard to imagine a law school, the Auckland Law School, without Stephen Pink here. And I then also wanted to introduce the four people who are sitting over there, my four colleagues. All these four colleagues are the leaders of the Part 2 courses. They're all professors, which is the most senior academic rank that you can have, and they're all leaders in various ways in their field. So I just wanted to briefly introduce them to you. I wanted to introduce first, sitting on the left, Professor Julia Tolmie. Now, Professor Julia Tolmie leads the criminal law course. So the criminal law course, which many of you, if this is your beginning part two, will be taking this year, Julia leads that course. Julia, as well as being a highly regarded scholar, also participates in the wider environment, in that she chaired the Family Violence Death Review Committee that is actually leading to changes in our domestic violence law in New Zealand. So here's someone who's one of your professors who's also really making a difference in the wider world. Then next to her is Professor Joanna Manning. Now, Professor Joanna Manning is leading the Torts course. Jo, if you get this month's Metro magazine, just as another example, and you turn to, I think it's page 41, you'll see a picture of Jo Manning, because Jo Manning has been part of the Cartwright Collective, which was involved in drawing light on the unfortunate experiment at National Women's Hospital, and that's been in the news recently if you've watched the Sunday programme. And Jo was one of the group that's continued working to make sure that the sort of things that happened in the early 1980s with that experiment don't happen again. So her area of research is medical law and health law. But again, this is someone who takes their research and what they do into the wider world. And then next to Professor Manning is Professor Janet McLean. Now, Professor Janet McLean is an internationally known scholar in public law. So if you travel to universities or in any part of the common law world, people will know who Professor Janet McLean is. She's an internationally renowned scholar in her field of public law. And we're very fortunate to have someone like Professor McLean teaching and leading the Part 2 public law course at Auckland Law School. And then finally, sitting on the very right is Professor Francis Dawson. Now, many people, when they think back about their time, their first year in Part 2 law at Auckland Law School, they remember Francis Dawson and his lectures in contract law. So last week, Francis had lunch, and he wouldn't tell you this, but he had lunch with some judges, and they talked about what an impact the way Francis taught contract law had on them. So he's a truly memorable lecturer who is at the very core of how you understand what it is to be a lawyer, how to have what legal reasoning is, what legal thinking is. So again, we're fortunate that we have Francis, who's leading our contract law course. Francis was someone who went into practice and was hugely successful, but chose to come back here and lead the contract law course for Auckland Law School. So I think we're just incredibly fortunate that the foundation courses, criminal law, torts law, public law, and contract law are led by four such fantastic people who are true leaders in their respective fields. So now I'm going to hand over to Stephen Pink, who's going to talk to you about some other matters to do with this year that you're and facing. And I just want to wish you all good luck. We have it's something new. It's challenging. Sometimes students find it stressful. There's help from everyone. You will never knock on anyone's door at the law school and find that it's not open if you have concerns. So please take advantage of if you're feeling stressed, talk to people, don't become stressed, but actually treat this as a positive opportunity, because it's something very exciting as you start on your journey to becoming trained lawyers.
Morning, everyone. Many of you I recognise from Legal Method classes from the last year or two, and some of you I've got to know quite well through the admission process over recent months, and in some cases, over recent years. So you've been congratulated by Harry on behalf of the faculty and by our Deputy Dean, and let me add my personal congratulations to you for having made it. The topic is said to be planning part two, the LLB structure. I do want to talk about that briefly and maybe dispel a couple of myths, but I thought it might be more useful to tell you in some detail about the selection process, how many competitors you faced, and to know something about the cohort to which you belong. So we'll have an analysis of this year's part two intake and see so that you can identify yourself as amongst the people who surround you. Each year we have to make a selection for part two because the demand for places greatly outstrips the supply. And in recent years, somewhere between 800 and 900 students have applied each year for the 300 or 380, as it was this last time around, places that are available. So you can see that the demand exceeds the supply by about a 2-to-1 ratio. The number of places that have been allocated this year was determined, as some of you will recall, only in October last year by the University Council. In fact, it was in the very last week of classes in the second semester last year. It was on the Wednesday of that week that the University Council decided to increase the Part 2 intake numbers from 330 to 380 places. So we had 50 additional places to allocate. In our last Legal Method class at the end of the second semester last year, we speculated on what that might mean in terms of the grade point average required for admission to Part 2. And because there were 50 additional places, we thought that, based on past experience, particularly the last 3 or 4 years, that the GPA was likely to fall a little. It had been at 6.4, and we speculated that it might be around 6.2. It actually went up. It went up to 6.5, and I'll show you what it has been over the last 30 years in a few minutes. So spare a thought for those people who, just below 6.5, thought that they were likely to be selected and, in fact, haven't. Spare a thought for them because they would like to be sitting where you're now sitting. Bear them in mind as you work through the rest of your law degree. The consequences of having such a high entry standard are, firstly, that it gives rise to a lot of anxiety as well as competition for places. And I know many of you were anxious when you were in part one, and that anxiety sometimes manifested itself in positive ways and sometimes in less fortunate ways. But it is also a recognition of the high standards that this law school has, the high entry standards, which ultimately is going to be to your advantage in terms of your employment prospects. To those of you who have worked terribly hard to get to this point, let me congratulate you on now being rewarded for your hard work. And for those of you that have persisted, and there are amongst you at least 3 people who have made it into law school on their 3rd or subsequent attempt, then let me congratulate those people in particular for their persistence, their determination, and the increase in their GPA that has allowed them finally to qualify. All right, so who are we? Well, before we answer that question, let me just do what I said I would a moment ago and show you the grade point average that's been required in each of the last 30 years for admission to part two, and the number of places that have been available. So when I was first associated with the law school in the mid-1980s, there were 200 places available in the second year of the law degree, or the first law examination, as it was called, the first professional year. It followed an intermediate year in which students took 6 arts or science courses. So there was no law in the first year of the law degree. 6 courses, a standard full-time program at the time, 6 papers, and they had to be in arts or science, and they had to include 2 courses, 2 papers, in a language subject or in philosophy. The number of students taking law intermediate was about 400, so you can see that it was roughly half of those who completed the first year, the intermediate year, who were allowed to progress with their law degrees. And the average grade that was needed for selection at the time was about a B- average, or a GPA of 4. Now you can see the 200 available places in the mid-80s became 225 places in 1988. That's when we moved the legal system course, which is law and society and legal method combined, from second year into first year. But despite the greater availability of places, the grade point average went up. The 225 places were increased to 270 in 1991, but still the grade point average continued to climb despite the greater availability of places. 300 places available from 2005 onwards. But the GPA is now above the B plus threshold, 6.25 in the year 2005. And you can see it continued to increase up to 2010, where it peaked at 6.7. So that's getting closer to an A minus than a B plus. And since that 6.7 peak in 2010, for the last 5 or 6 years, it's leveled out. So over the last 5 years, when we had formally 300 places available, but actually each year admitted rather more, usually somewhere around 325 to 330. So we oversubscribe by about 10% because we could actually squeeze 330 students into three streams of 110. It's been in the middle of the B plus to A minus range. And then of course, the council increased that intake to 380, but that's not 380 plus, it's a strict 380. So it's 50 additional places rather than 80 additional places as compared to the previous few years. And as we've noted, the grade point average perhaps unexpectedly went up a little, so 6.5 is what was required to guarantee you a place. Now that's in terms of general admission to part two. Some students have been admitted with lower grade point averages under the various targeted admission schemes, and we'll discuss those in a moment. Who are we? Who are you? Well, in fact, and we'll just magnify that a little. We initially offered, just before Christmas last year, 382 places to domestic students. And students who were just below 6.5 GPA were placed on a wait list in case any of those 380 students should decline the offer. Some did. And so we were able to go to the wait list and offer students on 6.4 a place. Some students on 6.4. There were in fact 19 students who were waitlisted. As students, having accepted their place and enrolled, then changed their minds and withdrew, we were able to continue to access the wait list. And eventually everybody on the wait list has been offered a place, but it's a limited place. So the last of you were admitted only in the last 10 days or so. And you've been offered a place which is where you've been, well, where we've had a seat available, basically. So you might have expected to be doing criminal and public law this year, and in fact you've been offered torts and contract, or something other than what perhaps you were expecting. But the advantage of having been admitted this year is that you are now in a secure place, and irrespective of your performance this year, you won't have to compete again for a place in part two. So when you come to do the balance of part two next year, if you're not doing the whole of it this year, then your place is guaranteed and you will in fact have first choice of the courses and streams before the incoming students next year. So 378 is the number that we've actually ended up with after some students have withdrawn. And in addition, there are 6 international students. So a total intake of 384. Typically in our intake, we have between 40 and 50 graduates. This year there are only 25, so the demand by graduates for admission has dropped a little, or at least the demand for admission by graduates with sufficiently high grade point averages has dropped. Graduates require the same GPA as undergraduates. The 7 transferring students are students, one of them is a student who has just completed last year part one at another New Zealand law school and is transferring to Auckland. The other 6 are students who were already in part two at another law school, but because of the different degree structures, they haven't yet covered all of our part two requirements. So for example, somebody who's at AUT does not do criminal law in part two, but in part three of the degree. So if they've done AUT's part two and they want to transfer to us, they still have criminal law to do. Criminal law has restricted numbers. They have to compete for 1 of 6 places that are available for transferring part two students. And as you can see, we have filled those 6 plus the 1 other transferring student who had only just completed part one. Most students are doing conjoint degrees. So you'll see that the most popular combination is arts and law, 40% of students. Just over a quarter of you are doing commerce and law conjointly, and there are small numbers of students doing the various other combinations, engineering and law, health science and law. Music and law, for the very first time, is being introduced this year, and there is one student doing that combo. Property and law, and science and law. So arts, commerce, science are the three most popular in that order, and then comparatively small numbers than the others. And the number of students doing a single LLB is 94, or just on one quarter of the cohort. This information is drawn from SSO, so it is from the statistical data that you have supplied to the university. Its binary allows only two choices when it comes to gender. So 243 of the 384 students have identified as female, and you'll see that that is close to two-thirds of the intake, or just over 63% this year, down a little from the 68% in 2016. But if you average it out over the last 4 years, you can see that women students have been increasing in numbers as a proportion of the intake, and now roughly two-thirds of the intake. And men, 141 of the 384, or 36.7%. And the comparative figures are there for the last 3 years. When it comes to ethnicity, then from the statistical data, 156 people have identified as Pākehā, New Zealand European, 123 are Asian, 44 Māori, 38 Pacific, 21 from other minority groups, and two students who are not quite sure where they belong. They belong in the Auckland Law School, but in which ethnic group is yet to be decided. Total of 384. Now, it's interesting if you look at the first line that the proportion of Pākehā students has been steadily decreasing, and the percentage of Asian in particular has been increasing, so that the stereotype of the white male lawyer or law student is now defied, and a law student is more likely to be an Asian woman than a Pākehā man. As I said, we have a number of targeted admission schemes or processes for students with disabilities, for students with refugee backgrounds, for students that have suffered particular hardship, for students transferring from Part 2 at other New Zealand law schools, as I've already mentioned, for students from low socioeconomic backgrounds, for Māori students and for Pacific students. The reasons for having targeted admission schemes include addressing disadvantage, role modelling, encouraging diversity, and reflecting society. And in particular, the numbers of places that are set aside for Māori and for Pacific students are determined by the number of people in the general community who identify as Māori and Pacific, so that the law school's hope is that we might reflect in our intake the percentage of Māori and Pacific people that there are in society generally. And you'll see that from those figures that 11.5% Māori and just on 10% Pacific, which is an increase from the previous years, don't quite meet the proportions of people in the general community, but we're heading in the right direction. All right, the LLB structure, and I won't be very long about this, and most of you are familiar with it already. In the handbook which you've got in your pack on page 11, there is this diagram. And the comment that I want to make about the structure of the LLB is that it is a professional degree. It is a professional degree, and it is structured rather differently from the more general bachelor's degrees, such as the BA, the BCom, the BSc, the BProp. So there is no major in law. There is no need to specialise in your law degree. You may if you wish, but there is no obligation to do so. Your major or your specialisation or your plan is law. The law degree consists of a mix of compulsory and elective law courses. So the compulsory ones are the blue and the elective are the red. And you'll see that part two consists entirely of compulsory courses. So legal research, writing, and other communication, 10-point course, is the first one you must take. Whatever else you're doing, you need to be enrolled in Law 298. And then there are criminal, public, torts, and contract law, each weighted at 30 points. So the points total for part two is actually 130. Part three is a mix of compulsory and elective courses. And part four, apart from a means of checking that you've done enough writing and participated in moots and so on, consists entirely of elective courses. So the points totals are for parts one to four, respectively, 120, 130, 120, and 110. So what that indicates is that part two is particularly heavy, but the relief comes at the end of the degree, where part four, having only 110 points, means that the overall total is 480, 4 years of 120 on average. As for the elective courses, you don't take a specific number of courses, but you take a number of points, and the courses come in different weightings. So we have large, medium, small, and you can have fries if you want, 20, 15, and 10 points respectively. Because part four consists only of elective courses, and each year there are about 50 to choose from, some in summer school, four or five typically, others in the first semester and in the second semester, it is possible in that final part of the degree to go on exchange, and roughly one-fifth of our Part 4 students do. So we have a number of specific exchange agreements with other law schools around the world, and then there are all the general university-to-university student exchange agreements that the University of Auckland participates in, and so there are about 100 possibilities for you to do some of your study overseas, have an OE while you are still studying, get some credit for the courses that you've done in another jurisdiction, have access to the elective courses offered by a law partner law school overseas, and all within the time frame for your LLB degree. In respect of conjoint degree students, and that's most of you, the structure is there, and I won't go through it in detail, but I do want to point out right at the top that it says sample. So while some students beginning part two, as most of you are doing, take criminal law and public alongside legal research, writing, and communication, it is not necessary to do so. And indeed, some of you have been denied that opportunity because by the time you came to enrol in criminal law, you might have found that it was already full. You're doing something else instead. That is not a concern. As long as you're doing legal research, writing, and communication, and at least one other course, then your enrolment is entirely valid. And there is no need to be concerned that you haven't adhered to this particular arrangement. It is only one of many possibilities. Let's say this year you are doing criminal, public, and contract, and the only course you are not doing is torts, so you haven't adhered to this arrangement strictly. You've got a little more law in there than most conjoint students. Does that mean next year you can do only the remaining course for part two law? No, it doesn't. You don't have to have completed part two to be able to start part three. So that's the other myth that I wanted to dispel. One myth is that you must adhere to the structure. You don't. You haven't to. And the other is that it is possible to be completing one part of the degree and starting on the next part simultaneously. So don't feel that you're going to have to spend 2 years completing part two before you get access to the part three courses if you're a conjoint degree student. The only other thing that I wanted to mention, which is just something for you to bear in mind and possibly aspire to, is the honours degree. So the honours degree in law is quite different from honours degrees in other faculties. Generally, throughout the university, there are two models. So in engineering, for example, you complete a bachelor's degree, a four-year degree with honours, if your grades are sufficiently high. In most faculties, the honours year comprises 120 additional points over and above the basic bachelor's degree. So a three-year BA, 120 points beyond the BA for BA honours. And those courses, those 120 points, are at the 700 or the postgraduate level. Similarly with BCom honours, BSc honours, a whole extra year on top of the BCom or the BSc. Law honours, because lawyers always do things differently, is in a category all of its own. It's sui generis. That is to say, it requires 60 additional points, not 120. They are at the 700 level. And it is typical that students do 20 of those points in part three of their degree an honours seminar course, weighted as 20 points, and a dissertation, so that's a piece of original research, resulting in 15,000 or so words, at the end of part four, often in the summer following the completion of part four or in the first semester of the year following. So it's a half a year's extra work, but it can actually be squeezed into the standard time frame. You can enter the honours programme as early as the end of part two, so long as at the end of part two, your overall average on your law courses is at least a B+. So taking into account your law and society result, your legal method result, and your grades for criminal, public, torts, and contract, if you have that B+ average, 75% average, then you'll be invited to transfer to the honours programme. And finally, because I've exceeded my time, just some housekeeping matters. I won't run through them in detail, but just to alert you in the handbook to the information, particularly the academic information for students that's set out on pages 30 to 39. Warren Swain will alert you to some particular detail within there. And turning back to page 22, you will see identified the directors of all of the courses in the law school, including the part two courses. And it is my pleasure now to ask the first of those to come and address you about criminal law. Julia, thank you.
Hi, I'm Julia Tolmy, so I'm the course director for criminal law, and I'm going to start by just doing a little exercise to refocus our attention. Might take a little bit of courage. I'm going to ask those of you in this room who have committed a crime to put your hands up. Gosh, what an unusual cohort of young people. Only a small number have committed crimes. That means there are people in this room who have never done one of the following things. They've never smoked marijuana or taken ecstasy or some other designer drugs and gone to a dance party. They have never committed theft. They have never taken something without someone's permission, knowing that they plan to use it and might damage it, even if they hope they don't and intend to return it. They have never assaulted someone, contacted someone else's body without their consent, or threatened to do so. They have never used indecent or offensive words in a public place. In other words, sworn. They have never attempted to bring into hatred, contempt, or excite disaffection against Her Majesty or the government of New Zealand. They have never urinated in a public place other than a public toilet. I'm willing to bet about 60% of the people in this room haven't done that. They've never tried and failed to do any of those things. That amounts to the law of attempt, criminal law of attempt. So basically what this exercise tells us is that pretty much all of us commit crimes. Absolutely normal behaviour. But most of us have lives that insulate us from having the label criminal attached to us. The other thing it tells us is that most offending doesn't come to the attention of authorities. It's what we call the dark figure of crime. So looking at some of those issues is a tiny part of the criminal law course. Why do people commit crimes? Or more like, why aren't most of us caught and processed through the criminal justice system? But it's not the main focus of this course. In this course, we look at the criminal offences themselves. We take a selection of them and we teach you how to analyse them. What do you need to prove to establish criminal liability? What are the general defences? What are some of the different ways in which you can be a criminal? Because the reality is you don't just have to do it. If you encourage your mate to urinate in a public place, you're actually guilty as a party by inciting their offending. So we look at those particular issues, the criminal law itself, in this course, primarily. You will have three lectures a week. You're divided into two streams. One is taught by myself, and the other is taught by Dr. Fleur Te Aho, who has just come to us from the Australian National University, where she's completed her PhD. I'm pretty excited about having Fleur on board. Fleur comes with a background in Indigenous rights and human rights, which is a really important lens to place on this particular subject. So you will have three lectures a week. You will do eight tutorials, small group tutorials over the course of the year in fortnightly rounds, and they will start the week commencing the 13th of March. You will have to complete over the course of the year a court observation. a midterm test in semester one, a tutorial essay in semester two, and a final examination at the end of the year. And you will be given grades for your tutorial participation. I'm going to finish by just reading a letter that I received from one of our alumni in 2012. So for years I was the editor of our alumni magazine, Eden Crescent. When you graduate from this institution, it will pursue you wherever you go in the world and find you, containing information about us. It goes to about more than 8,000 alumni all over the world. And this was in 2012, I received a letter congratulating me on the 2012 edition of Eden Crescent. Dear Julia, I write to compliment you on the 2012 edition of Eden Crescent. And then the author goes on to talk about the different articles and how much he enjoyed them. Thank you, Julia, and editorial support team, much appreciated. Unfortunately for me, I am currently in custody at Mount Eden awaiting trial on a raft of charges involving alleged financial improprieties. And he goes on to talk about basically what he's been accused of and asking for back issues of Eden Crescent. The paucity of reading material here is just bad. The point of that is, not only might this degree be of value to you in your professional career, it may actually be of great value to you, this particular course, in your personal and professional life. Now, hand over to Joe.
Sorry, folks, that was actually me. That was the author of that letter. And not just that, I forgot to admit that I'm currently being pursued for parking fines as well as child support. So next up, we're just actually going to skip public and we're actually just going to jump to torts with Professor Joanna Manning. I work with a bunch of ladies, and in torts you'll realise there's intentional torts as well as negligence. A particular aspect of intentional torts is there's infliction of emotional distress.
Oh, that was an assault.
Due to me.
Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Welcome. I'm Jo Manning. I'm the course director of the torts course. You'll see me the first week of the semester. I'll be teaching both streams of torts. I'm not going to congratulate you again. I think you're all getting very big heads and you'll have trouble getting out the doors. Just remember, with the privilege comes responsibility. You'll have responsibility to your communities for having the privilege of studying a law degree. But in addition, I'd like to suggest to you that your horrible year is over. Your cutthroat year is over, part one. You're in now. It's time to really start to enjoy your legal studies. And also, I mean, week after next, I'm going to dinner with a group of friends who all sat where you're sitting now. I was educated at this law school, and I still keep in touch with these friends. I don't want you to do the maths, but over 30 years we've been meeting each other. And so it's time to get to know each other and to start enjoying the other students who are in your classes and in your tutorials. Form some networks, form some friendships, and some of the most important friendships in your lives will be made here at law school. So forget about being competitive, it's time to get supportive of each other. You'll find that much more fulfilling way to go, and it'll make for a happier time here. For many people, their years at law school are the happiest times of their lives. It's a very positive experience in that you're learning and you're growing. It's busy, but it should be enjoyable. And if it's not, you want to start asking why that is. Okay, so as I say, you'll see me next week. Torts. What is torts? Torts is the study of civil wrongs. It's a private law subject, and it's part of the law of civil obligation. And it covers a number of personal wrongs, not including breach of contract, that can be compensated for by an award of damages as well as other remedies. It's a case law heavy subject, so the casebook is available for you to go and purchase at the university bookshop, and in it there'll be extracts from court decisions. And so one of the things that we really want to teach you this year is legal reasoning. You did some of it in your legal method course. So one of the very best things you can do and commit to is, where possible, I know that life can get in the way, but where possible you should read for class, because that's just a mileage thing. The more you do it, and you know, sometimes you have to tie yourself to the chair and lock the fridge in order to do your reading for class, but it gets easier and easier, and you start to know what you're looking for, because it's not just about learning content information, because a few years, well, you do torts this year, next year that information will already be getting out of date, so you need to know how to stay current, how to find and read the latest court decisions that come out after you've finished your torts course. So, number one message, where possible, read for class. The more you do it, the more you're going to enjoy it. I promise you that. So, as I say, torts is a study of a number of civil wrongs. The key one is negligence, which is the everyday stuff of a lawyer. And you will be doing that with my colleague Hannah Wilberg later on in the first semester. Julia covered pretty much the torts course is similar, three lectures per week. Those lectures are not compulsory, but tutorials, attendance at tutorials is in torts. There's a participation component or mark attached to it. And during the tutorial program, you will get experience for the first time in doing a moot, a torts moot. So you'll all be assigned to do a moot by your tutors, and they will explain how that works. So that'll be your first opportunity to exercise those nascent advocacy skills, and it's an introduction to the general mooting program later in the degree. So there's eight rounds of tutorials. Many of you will have signed up for tutorials on Canvas already. Also this year, for the first time, given that we're a bigger group of 380 students in two big streams, we're introducing some clinics and torts. There'll be four or five clinics. Those aren't compulsory, but you're strongly encouraged to attend those. They'll be in smaller groups. And they will be led by a new assistant lecturer who we're very excited to join the torts team, Nikki Chamberlain. And those will be scheduled close to the times that you have pieces of work for the course, like the test or the essay, and for exam preparation. So there'll be more information about those clinics later on. Okay, I think that's all I have. Thank you. Welcome, and I'll see you all next week.
Thanks, Jo. Jo and I studied together, so don't be too phased when she pushed me. We just wanted to demonstrate what a battery looks like, or an assault. So next up, we have Professor Janet McLean, who will be taking public law, which is 211, Law 211, and you'll be discussing various aspects of public law. So, i.e. if we wanted to build a wall between us and the AUT Law School. Thank you.
Thanks. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Welcome. Very lovely to see you here. I'm the public face of public law. I'm the course director this year. We have a team taught program. I won't be seeing you till the second semester, when I come in to teach bills of rights and judicial review and holding politicians accountable. We're going to lead off with Professor Bruce Harris, who's going to introduce you to public law, to our origins here in Aotearoa, New Zealand, and to how we govern ourselves. Now, public law, it's fair to say, we can't boast urinating in the street, we can't boast battery. We're thought of as being the boring public law course, the boring part two course that you have to get through. And I'll tell you why we're considered boring. It's a complete misconception, of course. It's because we talk about the rules of the game. We talk about how, who rules us, how we rule ourselves, how we hold our rulers accountable. We ask questions like, does power rule or does law rule? And most of the time, the rules just happen and they're like wallpaper. You don't notice because the rule's already there. In fact, a friend of mine told me a story. He was a judge's clerk working in Australia. He was in a very boring court case. It was about two rival business competitors. And the case went on and on. The day was hot. The barristers spoke slowly for the stenographer. They repeated themselves. He thought, am I in the wrong job? At lunchtime, he watched CNN. It was a story about his home country, his country of birth, Greece. It involved a dispute between two rival business competitors. They were gunning each other down in the street. He went back to court and he said, order, law. This is a luxury that we've taken for granted. This is a privilege to be in a place where there are rules, where there is certainty, where people can plan, and where the change of government doesn't mean your life, your business, your world is over. Now, we're living in a world, let's just say, where there are interesting times, where things are changing, where unprecedented things are happening, where constitutions are tested. I defy you to think that public law is boring. So we're going to face an election year this year. I want to talk about human rights, holding politicians accountable, public order, self-determination, for the Indigenous people of this country, but also for all of us. How do we rule ourselves? Okay. So this is quite a political course, but it's also about law. And we're going to be building on the legal skills that you were introduced to last year. And in public law in particular, the bits that are indented that you tend not to read, that is, the statutes, will be really important. So our emphasis is going to be on principle and statutes. How we work this out together, the reasoning, the principles that that are throughout our constitution. Do we even have a constitution in New Zealand? It's text-based, it's argument-based, and it's not about rote learning. So come prepared to face new problems and to have a little bit about passion about why public law or the wallpaper of order that we take for granted might be important. One last thing, one nuts and bolts thing. It's only mentioned today. You've got too much in your heads. We're telling you too much, but we'll run the same way as most of the other courses, three lectures a year, a week, eight tutorials. Our public law opinion is already online on Canvas. It's due in the second half. It's completely self-directed learning. We won't be lecturing on judicial review before you have to answer the public law opinion. And that opinion is compulsory for you to sit the exam. So that's one difference between public law and the other courses this year. So I really look forward to seeing you in the second half. Any questions for me about the first half too? Kia ora koutou.
And for our final speaker, he's a son of West Auckland. Everyone give it up without the mullet, Francis Dawson.
good morning. I am the course director of contracts. Course director is a very difficult concept. It's like the great high priest. I show you where the light is. I direct you towards the light, but I'm really rather like a head gardener. The garden has to be tilled, and you have to do the hard work of actually getting to understand about the subject. As you would expect, the law of contracts is about enforceable agreements. And the way we learn that is to go through carefully about 200 cases. The cases are in the casebook. The first 100 or so are in here. And the task is not, as in torts, that you've been directed, try and read your cases. That won't do at all. You must read your cases, and the only way to really understand the subject is to read every case three times. And that's not three times in one go. It's three different times. And what you'll find is it's the third time that the points just drop into place. Now, our objective as the teachers of contract is to expose you to 200 real life events so that when you are asked by clients, what do I do here? You will have a response, because these are the leading cases, you do this. You'll find that in practice, in real life, the points don't come nicely packaged as what is the law in Folksomebeer, which is one of the cases in the book. They come with a client being exposed to a point in the middle of a hard negotiation. A document will be slipped across the table and it'll be passed down to you as counsel. And your client will say, do we accept this proposition or not? Now you have immediately to isolate the significance of that clause and how it will work for your deal. This is anticipating here that you're a commercial lawyer and in the middle of a deal. You'll find that contracts is at the base of every significant part of law. It's the heart of property law. It's at the heart of banking law. It's at the heart of corporate and M&A law. It is the most interesting subject of the four, by a mile. And
it's too much, Francis.
Sorry? No. I haven't even got going yet. I was once asked, what do you think of the other subjects? And I explained, well, I thought that public law was quite important. Crimes you had to deal with if you were exposed and you're in trouble. Torts, well, you might come across that once or twice. But contracts, you dealt with all the time, five times a day, every moment of the day. And a student said to me, no, Francis, you haven't got it at all. This is the way that you should look at it. Public law is like marching music. Crime is like punk rock. Torts is like modern jazz. But contracts, that's Mozart. You can see from the style of my dress that I'm slightly old-fashioned. I did this about 40 years ago last time, and I'm pleased to say that all three, Susan, Julia, and Joe, were students of mine long time ago. So despite the fact that we all look like Peter Pan, it's not true. Now, I do want to leave you with one really important point, and that is you must read your cases, right? Three times. Buy the book, and start reading. It's not going to be fun. Don't think of that. It's not. It's going to be a grind. But you will find it intellectually challenging, and you will find it intellectually interesting. Won't have the drama of crimes, won't have the drama of public law, won't have the drama of torts. That'll be incredibly satisfying. We have a test in the end of this term for 30%. It's plussage. We have an opinion of 10%. And we have the unequal struggle at the end of October or November, the final exam, for either 100% or 60% if you've done well and you're carrying good grades over. All right, so work hard towards that. Read your cases three times. I leave you. I won't see you till the end of this semester. We're going to have three teachers this semester and two next semester. We'll have a first bracket of 5 weeks, second bracket of 6 weeks, and then I'll take over for 10 weeks. Make sure that you get the previous stuff out of the way, and we get on to right lines and right thinking. So look, listen to Mozart to get in the swim of things, and very well done for getting in here. I look forward to the privilege of lecturing you.
Thank you to the High Priest Francis Dawson. Make sure that I'll send our regards to Pontius Pilate as well. Bring your tithings, aka your readings, to the contract temple, and give to the Lord what is the Lord's in Caesar, what is Caesar. Can I get an amen? I think we're stuck. Okay, all right, folks. Next up, we have Professor Warren Swain. But before we do, I know we've just got some people who have just arrived. If you can turn to the person next to you and say congratulations. Turn to the person on your left, say congratulations. Come on, take a chance to meet your person. And I want you to give the person in front of you a high five. You know, high five. If you've got all five fingers, you know, just give a high five. Awesome, folks. Thank you very much. I just done that because I saw a back row all sleeping when Francis was talking. But not to worry. Next up, we've got a Professor Warren Swain. Professor Warren Swain, who will be running through study techniques as well as just touching on our tutorials. If you can please join me in welcoming Professor Lance.
Welcome to everybody. I have the dubious pleasure of the graveyard slot, in that you've been sat here for an hour already, so I will be quite brief. I would, though, take issue with Professor Dawson. I also teach contract. I would say contract law is more Bach than Mozart. Bach being a superior composer by a long way to Mozart. But my name is Professor Warren Swain. I'm here in my capacity not as a contract lecturer, but as the Associate Dean Academic and Teaching and Learning, which is a rather long title. I make no comment on that. But it does make me responsible for undergraduate teaching and assessment. Those of you studying contract law, which will be a small number of you, as most of you will be doing criminal and public, will see me in the first 6 weeks before Easter. I should note 6 weeks and not five. I think we lost a week with Francis somewhere. I'm here, though, today to talk very briefly about study techniques and tutorials. I'll begin with the great English poet, W.H. Auden, who wrote a poem, wrote many great poems, but one of which is the poem Law is Like Love. in which he contrasted the different senses of law, the law of nature, the law of religion, etc. He devoted a verse of that poem to law of the sort that you will study. Law, says the judge as he looks down his nose, speaking clearly and most severely. Law is as I've told you before. Law is as you know, I suppose. Law is, but let me explain it once more. Law is the law. I know little about the idea of love, so can't comment on whether the comparison is a valid one. But it's worth reflecting on the way in which the judge in Auden's poem presents the law as something certain and something definite. In many ways, it's the same way that lay people may think about the law as a set of very clear legal rules that are easy to apply. As you will realise after studying law in part one, the truth is rather more complicated than that. The law is often contradictory. Judges in different cases, or even sometimes in the same case, say different things. They may reach the same result for quite different reasons. Well, how do you go about making sense of this complexity? Well, I talked to all of the course directors from part two, who you've just heard from. And I'll no doubt repeat some of the things that they say, but it won't hurt to repeat them. They all identified for me what they thought was important about studying law, and to which I've added my own thoughts. It has to be said that between us, we have rather a lot of experience of teaching of law. More than any of us care to remember, but I would hazard a guess it's significantly more than a century combined, which is rather a frightening thought. So lesson number one, perhaps, as emphasised quite rightly by Professor Dawson, is the importance of the case law. You need to read the cases, as Francis rightly said, not just aim to read them. Merely having a case book doesn't mean that somehow the cases will get into your mind by osmosis. Even if you do not understand the case the first time, you should read it again. The key really is not to give up. Reading cases actually honestly becomes easier, but it takes practice. Like anything, the more you do it, the easier it gets. The same is true of statutes that Professor McLee mentioned. Students are frightened of statutes for some reason, but again, it's important not to be frightened, though they will cause you some frustration, as indeed they do experienced lawyers. No one, of course, at this stage is a fully formed lawyer, so you shouldn't expect too much of yourselves. You mustn't expect to run before you can walk. It all takes time. And this is why the part two courses span two semesters. It's important to bear that in mind because things build cumulatively. So don't get despondent if the whole thing doesn't make sense to you after one lecture. Well, what is the purpose of the lectures? The lectures are designed to give the subject matter some structure. They are an introduction to crucial ideas. They're emphatically not the whole of your learning. You have responsibility for your own learning, which means reading the cases, as Francis quite rightly said, before the lectures, and doing the reading for tutorials. There are some expectations about the work that you should be putting into your law degree, which I'll just roughly outline, but it depends on how many credits a course is worth. But as a rough rule of thumb, for every hour spent in class, you should be working for 3 hours outside of it. And it's this time, actually, that is critical to doing well in the subject. But where do we start from? Well, we start by, if you're sensible, attending the lectures. But bear in mind that it's only possible to recall about 20% of what you hear, or even less. I'm sure from this morning you remember the comment about Mozart, that's for sure, but many of the details about assessment, etc., you may well not. It's tempting to let your mind wander and go onto Facebook and send emails. I understand that. I sit on very many important university committees and many of them are boring. It's very tempting to use those times to send emails. You should, though, try and resist that temptation. Lawyers really have to learn the skill of concentration. This was evident to me in another university where I used to judge mooting finals with those who were proper judges. And the attention and the concentration of those people was quite spectacular. I would sat there doodling on my pad, and my mind was wandering, and they would be able to concentrate. It's a skill that is important to get to grips with. Well, how do you remember what's said? Well, you need to develop the skill of taking notes. The trick lies in identifying what's important. It's a vital skill, this. And it's a vital skill for lawyers. I won't go into detail about all the research on learning, except to say that it's important to try and be an active learner. Well, what is being an active learner? Well, it's trying to engage with the content. And the first stage of engaging with the content is identifying what's important. What are the facts of the case that are critical to explaining the outcome? Which part of the judgment is the key part of the reasoning? But active learning involves putting your own order on the materials. It means that you should review your notes after the lecture, alongside your casebook and textbook reading. A word of advice here. You shouldn't leave all of this process to just before a test or an exam. It needs to be ongoing. It needs to start from the first class. The best way to learn is to read and reflect. Many students find it useful to form study groups. I strongly advise you to do so if you can. Well, what do we do to help you with this process? Well, firstly, it's our aim to provide you with some of the skills required to be a good lawyer and indeed a good law student. I don't here assume that all of you will go into legal practice. The degree, of course, opens up a whole range of opportunities. You are now in part two, and the Director of Legal Writing, Dr. Hood, will tell you about that course shortly. But that is a key part of giving you assistance in learning how to be a good lawyer, in that the course will teach you a great deal about different kinds of legal writing and how to express yourself in a lawyerly fashion. We also put on tutorials. These are important in that they contribute towards your final grade. But that isn't actually the most important reason to attend. Tutorials are designed to help you solve problems, legal problems, which is very good practice for the examination. But as Professor Dawson pointed out, the life of lawyers is about solving problems, and this is a start to the process. And there are four tutorials a semester, or eight in total. For those of you who'll be the minority taking tort and contract this year, as Professor Manning mentioned, we are piloting law clinics. Again, these are not compulsory, but I urge you to attend. These will provide opportunities to go over the material and maybe address things that you don't understand. it's important to remember that there's some law that everyone struggles to understand, even, and perhaps especially, some judges. Bits of law are difficult, but so you should take every opportunity amongst yourselves and by going to tutorials or if they apply clinics to work through legal questions. You can never have too much practice, and the more you do, the easier it becomes. But I would also end with a plea that you should make the most of university. Working for a degree is important, but it isn't everything. As somebody who spent their entire life at his desk, I would strongly urge you that that isn't a good lifestyle choice. Your degree shouldn't just be about working. There are lots of other opportunities, and you'll hear later from the student societies, which are very active, and you'll also hear about wellbeing. It's all really a question of balance. I'd like to just finish by thanking you all for listening, especially as I was right at the end, and wish you all an enjoyable part two of your degree. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Professor Warren Swain. Just sorry, guys. Sue, are we introducing the team now when we get back from the break? Now? Okay, after the break. All right, folks, it's the best time of, I guess, this whole program, and it's the break. So if you can just look at the clock, it's 20 past. If we could just have everyone here just before quarter to 11, quarter to 12 would be great. And thanks very much for your attention. Just out of interest, has anyone been to Samoa? Can you just raise your hands if you've been to Samoa? Oh, congratulations, blessed. The rest of you, shame on yous. Look, folks, I've just come from Samoa. I'm a bit homesick at the moment, but I know it's been a bit of a slog the first hour, but I'm just going to do what we call like whānau. It's just a brief little exercise just to get us up and running for the next segment. So how it goes is basically like this. Millie, so if I call Millie, everyone just Millie, like rub. So rub, so Millie, Millie, Millie. Millie, don't rub the person in front of you, just rub, okay? So Millie, when I call Batia, well, it's one clap, so Batia. Noa, Bati. Ah, see, he didn't listen, just testing. Failed the first step. So Batia is one clap, Noa, Bati is two claps, and then I go, hey, hey, everyone says, ho, yeah, not ho, you're not from Ponton B. No, say ho, okay? And forgive me, forgive those who are from Ponton B. Okay, so ready? Yeah, Millie, Millie, Millie. Batia. No, Bati! Hey, hey! Oh. And then we go, tiger, everyone, what does a tiger make? Ra? Ra. Okay, so ready? So tiger! Ra. Okay, come on, man, what tiger is that? So, a tiger from AUT! I want a real tiger from AU! So ready? Tiger! Ra. Buffalo! Woo! Yeah, okay, so ready? So let's do this together. Yeah, Billy, Billy, Billy. Batia! No, Bati! Hey, hey! Oh. Talking about a tiger? Rah. Talking about a buffalo? Ooh. Cool. Hey, look at that. You know, so when you approach a Samoa, you go mealy, mealy, mealy. And they might just punch you because you're rubbing them. Okay, folks, so just take a seat. Next up, I'm just going to introduce our team, our student centre team. And before I do, so are they going to introduce each other or will I just... Okay. Okay. All right, so... hope you guys have a wonderful break. I'd just like to welcome those who've just joined us. Punctuality is a key thing. If you don't come in on time, you'll miss out, and you'll have to put up with Warren Swain. Okay, so our student centre, I'd like to introduce our manager. Her name is Sarantika. She is over here. She's our student centre manager. On the side, she likes to breed dogs, and she has a canine by the name Oscar, and also loves to take Zumba classes. On her inside, to her left is Emily McGowan, who is our Student Academic and Support Advisor. In terms of extensions, this is the person that you want to bring or talk to. So come with gifts, obviously. Bribery is alive and well. Corruption is perfectly accepted at the Student Centre. Emily obviously looks after the undergraduate, anything to do with undergraduate studies as well as our equity programs. I'm Harry. I look after the Pacific students as well as any other matters. To Emily's right is Angela Va'ai. She is the postgraduate advisor. She's a full-time Netflix alcoholic. Oh, sorry, alcoholic. Sorry, Netflix. She's always watching Netflix. Does no work whatsoever. But it just happens to be part of our team. Also got Martina as well. She's a student academic and support advisor. Also works part-time for TripAdvisor because they're carrying. She's travelling around the globe with no leave. Next up, we have Catherine Arona, who is the Powhiwhenua Māori. She's also looks after our Māori students. Unfortunately, she didn't make Rio. She lost out to Lisa Carrington in the trials, but she loves to row. Jemima Ku, who has just come back from Hong Kong, also works for BuzzFeed Food. If you want any food tips, this is our girl to go to. She's also the part one advisor. So, I mean, that's not going to kind of, you're not going to need to see her unless you've got a cousin who's repeating it, or like me, three times. When Stephen said that, I was like, yes, that's me, repeated three times. And we've also got Tessa, who is also our student support and experience advisor. Tessa joins us from engineering, so if you've got some engineering students as well, please feel free just to touch base with Tessa and also pick your brains. Also got Lisa here. Oh, Lisa's obviously not here because then obviously the reception won't be open, but she's the person that will be obviously dealing and processing with all your assignments. Folks, can I just say one thing? Poor planning on your part does not constitute an emergency on our part. And as you can see, I work with a bunch of ladies who always torture me, so please don't give them grief if you haven't got any extensions or assignments incomplete, but just make sure that we are first port of call should you need absolutely anything. So I just want you guys to join me in thanking these wonderful ladies. Give it up for the Spice Girls, yeah. We're alive and wild. Bewitched over here. Okay, cool. So next up we have our introductory lecture for Law 298. So I'm just going to introduce our friends from Law 298. If they say their contract is Mozart, then we've got two of Destiny's Child here. Beyonce and Kelly Rowland. No one remembers Michelle anyway. She was just the third girl dancing at the back. So everyone give it up for Dr. Anna Hood as well as...
Good morning, everyone. It's awesome to see you all here. I'm sure everyone else has already congratulated you, but from me, congratulations on getting into law school. It is a huge achievement, and we're really thrilled to have you here. So Stephanie Carr, who's down here, and will pop up in a minute, and I are here to talk to you about Law 298, or Legal Research, Writing and Communication. I realise the title isn't one of the sexiest titles around town, and it's not necessarily the subject that will make your socks roll up and down all year, but it is a really important subject, and we hope a really enjoyable one. It's fairly new in the law school. So the top US and Australian law schools have for a number of decades now taught legal research, writing and communication courses. And we've been a little bit behind the eight ball. But over the last few years, the law school's done a lot of work talking to students, also talking to people in the legal profession. So partners in law firms, judges, people in small practicing firms, about what it is we need to be doing more of to equip you guys, both for law school and for what comes beyond that. And the thing that came back repeatedly was that we really need to do better at giving you the fundamental skills in research, writing and communication. So we developed this course, which we started for the first time last year, and it went really well, and we got some fantastic feedback. So a lot of the older students who missed out on doing this course constantly say to us, we really wish that we'd had this and we'd had this opportunity to learn these things. And the students who went through it last year were really positive about it. They found that it really set them up well for the assignments that they have to do in other courses at law school, but also those students who are doing part-time work in law firms or other businesses out and about repeatedly got feedback from people in their workplace that the quality of their work had gone up significantly. So we're really hoping that we have another great year and that you guys get a lot out of this subject. Now, in terms of slides working, all right. So it's a 10-point course, and it goes for the entire year. And as you can see, we're going to be covering legal research, writing, communication, also a little bit of well-being. In law school, obviously, a lot of your lectures, you're going to be in really, really big classes. In Law 298, you're going to be in classes of just 10 to 12 people. And that's partly so that you can get really good interaction with your teachers and get a lot of feedback from them. But it's also so that you get a chance to actually get to know some people in your year level and get, hopefully, some really great friendships and meaningful connections with others. Just to give you a very quick overview, the year starts with you doing legal research. So for your first 3.5 classes, you're going to be in the law library, and in particular in the computer lab in the law library. And the classes are going to be run by the law librarians, headed up by Stephanie. She's going to talk to you more about the research classes in a minute, but they'll be focusing on helping you find case law, legislation, books, journals, those kind of things. Halfway through the fourth class for Law 298, the library sessions will come to an end, and you'll be introduced to your legal writing instructors. And they're the people who will be taking you for the rest of the year. I'll talk a little bit more about the writing program after Steph's talked about research. But basically, we have a really great program that introduces you to a whole range of different forms of legal writing and really focuses on getting you up to speed with the various techniques you need to know. I realise many of you will be excellent writers already. You will have done extraordinarily well when writing in high school and in your Part 1 papers. Law school requires slightly different writing skills and techniques. So no matter where you are on with your level of writing, I think you're going to get a lot out of this part of the course. At the end of it all, final two classes, you do legal communication. And for this, we focus on negotiations and learning how to negotiate. If you become lawyers, you'll have to use a whole range of different oral communication skills. You may have to stand up in courtrooms, you may be involved in mediations, but the thing that you probably find that you will do the most is negotiate. And speaking to a friend of mine who's a barrister the other day, and she's a top barrister and is in court all the time, but she said that she reckons about 90% of her workload is actually negotiating, whether that's with clients and trying to get them to, you know, agree and work on something that's going to work for them, whether it's working with the other side and other lawyers or with judges. So it's a really, really important skill. If you have absolutely no intention of being a lawyer, I completely understand. This part of the course will still be useful for you. We teach you the Harvard style of negotiation, which is something that applies in the legal field, but it also applies in business and governance, and can be very helpful dealing with difficult partners as well. So, I'm going to come back in a minute and talk to you more about all of this, but for now I'm going to hand over to Stephanie so she can have a chat about the legal research part of the course.
Kia ora everyone, and congratulations on making it into part two. So here's me, it's probably a few years back now, but I'm your legal research coordinator. You can call me Steph. My email address, it's probably best if you contact Davis at auckland.ac.nz. That's nobody, you know, funnily out there. That's the Davis Law Library generic email, and that will make sure it gets to one of my team if I'm not there. And I have two hats at the law school. I'm not only your research coordinator, but I manage the law library. So my office is located in that building. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the research side, and in particular on Canvas. What we've set up for you is a legal research online resource. It's going to help you make it easy for your legal research content for first semester. Hands up if you know where Canvas is on the website. Oh, still some hands down. Okay, so if you are online, and it looks like it's logged me out, but you can get to Canvas a number of ways. I'm going to go the easy way, which is through the libraries, and there is a quick link to Canvas up the top there. Huh, doesn't like me. I'll just reset the student view. I've already had a few emails about Canvas, so it's just a quick reminder that if you are in Canvas and 298 is not showing on your dashboard view, hopefully like this, then go into courses on the left-hand menu and click all courses so that all the courses that you're enrolled in show up. If you've got it in the little tiles, it's nice and easy and you can just click into that. And you are dealing with a semester two option. The Legal Research Online course is halfway down. Once you click on that, you might be prompted for a password at some point, but you can work through all of the options within this. There's a menu and going through the classes. So what we recommend is that you read each of these before you come to the class. There are optional quizzes in each of the modules as well. So if, for example, you wanted to know more about finding books, you can test yourself with these little quizzes just to see whether you've understood the content or come prepared for the class. Check the answers. If you got them all incorrect, maybe you need to go back and look at the slides. Obviously, I need a bit of practice there. This will also be where all the communications for the course come from Anna and myself, so there'll be announcements where the assignments and everything is in that particular vessel for you. Now, as far as the legal research course content, the good news is that you've all been doing some research before you came to law school, whether it's, you know, your own social organisation of events or for your previous year at university. We're going to take that and transfer it into a legal environment. So we've got this exciting course that will help you decode the special language of law, and it will give you practical assistance that will help you not just with your law studies, but on into practice, if that's where you're heading. So when you write your legal essays or your opinions, you'll need to know how to analyse the information, how to find the relevant information, how to write it up. So your casebooks that you get don't give you everything that you need at law school, particularly if you want to do well. So there's a lot of work, there is a lot of information to absorb. Focus on your goal to keep you motivated. So you want to be like the young lady on the right of my screen instead of the young man asleep on the books. So you do need this course to pass law school through your LLB. And the legal research classes are confined to 3.5 of the content classes in semester one. In your course books, which I'll talk about in a moment, what you will find is this particular flow chart called the legal research process. I'm not going to dwell too much on this today. You don't need to memorize it or anything like that. But it shows you each of the research steps that we'll be focusing on for the 298 course. You start at the very top with analysing the facts, looking at the context, then you can consult your resources, you evaluate, you apply, and then you write it up. So we will keep returning to this flow chart in the future classes and keeping our legal methodology on track. So today's just a really brief intro to this to let you know what's coming up. The other thing you need to be keeping in the back of your mind is what's so different about legal information? Why do I have to even go to a class about legal research? Well, if you look at the online module on Canvas, what you will see is it's all about different types of materials. You're going to come across things like law reports and unreported judgments, so those might be new to you. And the structure, so it's a little bit different to other disciplines where you might hear the terms primary and secondary sources, but in law they are completely different meanings. We've got a different way of citing, and I'll talk to you in a moment about the New Zealand Law Style Guide. This is the prescribed text for the course. The way it's published is different, how it's cited, the structure, and the language that you're going to hear. Who's been watching How to Get Away with Murder? Yeah, awesome. So in one of the very first episodes, they go, who knows what actus reus is? And like everybody's going, blank face. Well, you're going to find out, and we'll show you the tools that you can use to do that. So the one thing you do need to be thinking about is the style guide. You'll be required to use this through all of your law school classes. We're up to the second edition. It's the black one. It's about $22 from the bookshop. You can get a print copy. We've got copies in the Davis you can borrow from the short loan for 2 hours use in the library. But there's also an online version. So up to you which you prefer to utilise. There are two recommended texts. You don't need to purchase these, so don't go to the bookshop looking and, you know, spending extra money. They're also available on the short loan in the Davis. The first one is the New Zealand Law Dictionary, and we're going to talk about dictionaries in Class 1. And that's by Peter Spiller. And that's going to help you interpret terms and phrases. So it's really useful. Just borrow those in the library. And also, if you get really enthusiastic about legal research, Mary Rose Russell's Legal Research in New Zealand will give you good guidance about that as well. Again, borrow from the library. You don't need to purchase these. I'm sure you're all aware that the Libraries and Learning Services website has been updated since the end of last year, and this will probably be a good portal for you to access a lot of the materials that we'll be talking about through the courses. The new catalogue is sort of like a Google bar, but you can drop down to all of the information for your databases and other links, including Canvas, up in the top left-hand corner as well. The reason I'm showing you this page is from the study option, so it goes help, study, research. If you click on study and then subject guides, the law subject guide is where you need to be, that environment for this year as well. So on your personal devices, bookmark this page. It's got quick links to Canvas, it's got the legal databases, information about the Davis, and at the very bottom, there is the link to the style guide. So it's a really important page. It's in the slides with the web address. I'm pretty sure you can find that. As far as the library is concerned, there are tours that are running from 6th of March to the 26th of March. You can see the times. They're entirely optional. But if you want to get ahead and know where things are in the Davis and all the ins and outs and the top tips, you might want to just come and take one of these for 10 to 15 minutes. There's no bookings required. There will be tours at the end of your class one as well, so this might just give you a little bit more information about what's going on in the Davis as well. Now you see the little picture with the little bears. We in the Davis have a little mascot called Barrister Bear. I'll tell you more about him in a moment, and that's his children, I think, following him around. But for 298, your first classes starting next week from Monday, you need to turn up to the Bell Gully Computer Laboratory. It's in the Davis Law Library, so when you come down the hill today for the barbecue, we're building 802 right in front of the red umbrellas. As you go in the library, you turn right, room 203 is the Bell Gully Computer Lab. So it's sponsored by one of our large firms in New Zealand, Bell Gully. And that's where the 298 sessions will be. Small workshops, as Anna has already mentioned. If you are interested, the Davis has a Facebook page, and Barrister Bear, or Barry as he's known, he gets up to a lot of antics, including reading the style guide in his free time. So you might want to have a look at that just to find out what's going on. And the one other thing I need to mention is that along with the style guide as the prescribed text, you also need to make sure on before Monday, before your first class, you get a copy of the green course book from the university bookshop. It's a practical workbook that you use as we go through the classes to do exercises, as well as it's got a lot of information in it. So please make sure you get that, the print copy. It's not available electronically. Thank you, guys. Have a great year. Anna's going to continue. So.
Thanks, Steph. Alrighty, just a very quick snippet on legal writing. Obviously, it's a few weeks away before you have to worry about this, but just to give you a brief overview of what you're going to be doing. First class you have, it's very nice and easy. You will just be meeting your writing instructor, getting to know a bit about them, they'll get to know a bit about you. We'll have a little bit of a chat about well-being, see how you're tracking. Then the rest of the semester, we give you some general writing tips for legal writing and focus on essays. And essays are something that you will have to write a number of over the next few years, so we try and set you up really well with the information you need for doing that. In semester two, we switch to more sort of real-world practical writing. We start off with problem questions. Obviously, you guys have already done some problem questions in part one, and you'll continue to do them this semester in your part two courses. We start with them because they are the absolute foundation of almost every single piece of legal writing you will do. And also, it's the chance you will get to get really detailed feedback on how you're going with them and to try and step you up from, if you're, you know, on a B, get you to the next bracket of a B plus, A minus. If you're on an A, get you an A plus. If you're a straight A plus student, then congratulations, well done. You can help the rest of the class. After that, we look at legal memoranda. And Legal memoranda is something that law firms use on a daily basis. So when you see a client in a law firm, you generally will write a piece of advice that will then get circulated around the other lawyers in your firm. So you need to learn how to do that, and we call that a legal memo. We'll teach you how to write to clients. Obviously, lawyers do that a huge amount, and so start getting you into the habits and the style of doing that. And then, as I mentioned before, we finish up with negotiation. All right, in terms of the legal writing teachers, I run the legal writing side of the program with Dr. Jane Norton, who's another lecturer in the law school. Unfortunately, Jane couldn't be here today, but she's really looking forward to meeting you guys. We also have then a team of 14 instructors who take the various different groups. They are an awesome bunch of people. They've got a whole range of different experiences. Some of them are practicing lawyers, some of them come from a more academic background, but they are a phenomenal team who you will get to meet, in due course. If throughout the year at any stage, whether it's in the research, writing or communication part, you have any questions at all, please come and see me, shoot me an email, come and knock on my door. I'm really happy to have a chat about anything and everything at any point. All right, finally, just some logistical bits and pieces to run over. Steph's already mentioned that the research classes take place in the law library, so that should hopefully be straightforward. In the fourth class, halfway through, you'll switch from the research to the writing. Your writing instructors will turn up in the Bell Gully Computer Lab and they'll take you to the classrooms you're going to be in for the rest of the year. So you don't need to worry too much about it, they'll take care of it all. But basically you're going to be in the 810 building, which is the Eden Crescent Short Street building across the road from the library. When are the classes? So the way Law 298 runs is on a 2-week cycle, which basically means in the first week of the cycle, half of you all have a class, and then half of you get the week off. Second week of the cycle, the other half of you have a class. So you only ever have Law 298 every second week of semester. You do need to work out which week you're in, and the best way of doing this, you've been assigned a workshop and a workshop number. If you have an odd number, so 1, 3, 15, 17, you are in week one, so that means your classes start next week, the week beginning 6th of March. If you've got an odd numbered workshop, 4, 6, 8, etc., then you're in the second week, you get next week off, and you start on the 13th of March. Make sense? Awesome. Okay. One of the real, I know you're getting a lot of information today. I really hope you remember every word that Steph and I have said. If you don't, please just remember this slide. It is for your own good. It is compulsory to attend Law 298 classes. Now, I personally have very mixed views about attendance being compulsory generally at university. You're adults, if you want to rock up, rock up. I think you should, it's great, but you know, it's on you. So I wouldn't normally be someone who would think compulsory attendance is important, but we do make it compulsory for a very important reason. And that is that this is a skills-based course. We don't give you a lot of reading outside of class. For most of your other subjects, you do a huge amount of work outside of class, as well as having to go to lectures. Here, the vast majority of the work you do is in the classroom. So we will be giving you exercises and feedback and so on that you can only get in the classroom, which is why the law school and the dean has decided that this is really, really important that you actually show up. If you miss a workshop without a legitimate excuse, you will lose 5 marks from the subject. So that means at the end of the year, if you've got 70%, you'll be taken down to 65%. Obviously, we understand that in life, things go wrong, you get sick, people you're looking after get sick, things happen. If you have, at any stage in the year, something that comes up, which means you just cannot make a class, please see the lovely Emily, who you saw before in the blue, and she can arrange for you to attend a different workshop. Emily, and the student advisor, is the only person who's able to sign off. I can't give you permission to attend another class, Steph can't, your instructors can't, and it's really, really, really important that you go and check in with Emily. Very quickly, assessment. You've got 2 worksheets and 2 tests for the research side of things. 4 assignments for legal writing and communication spread over the year. You're lucky, last year they had 5 for the legal writing side, so we've cut it down, and there's no exam. All right, as you mentioned before, Canvas is how we communicate with you, so keep an eye on it. We will keep it updated really regularly. Second to last thing, because I realise I'm running out of time, last year you should have done an academic integrity online course. If you're new to the university because you've transferred, please make sure you do it. If somehow you got through the system without doing it last year, please have a look. We take academic integrity matters really, really seriously. Unfortunately, last year we had a number of students who were caught copying work either from other students or from other sources, and that means that there's a really, really strict disciplinary process that kicks into place, and it has huge ramifications. It can result in you being kicked out of university. It can also result in you not being able to practice law in the future. This goes well beyond the gates of the university, so please check out the program. We've put stuff in the course book here to tell you what to do and not to do. If you're unsure at all, check it out. I really hope to meet all of you and have great conversations and get to know you. I don't want the first time to be when you're sitting in my office in trouble for plagiarism. So take note. All right, finally, as Steph said, make sure you get your course book, get a copy of the New Zealand Law Style Guide or have a look at it online, and make sure you've logged into Canvas. Any questions before we wrap it up? No? Awesome. Look forward to meeting you this year. Have a great rest of the day, and I'll catch you soon. Thanks, guys.
Everyone give it up for Kelly Rowland and Beyonce. Photos and autographs available later on. Cool, so just before we head into the next session, just want to introduce something new. So bo-bo means clap like this, like a clap, not with your pinky finger up, but bo-bo, so everyone just bo-bo mate, so keep it going, bo-bo. Once I go say, everyone just claps, okay? So once I say say, clap. Okay, so bo-bo mate, say. Gosh, unbelievable. You have made it into part 2. Congratulations. One more just before we introduce our thing. I'll just say, loa bati male focus, clap, focus. We'll save that one for next time. Yeah. How about that? Cicadas. All right. Okay, so next up we have. Oh, well, let's try it, eh? Let's try it. So, loa bati male focus. Okay, this is not a silent class. We can say focus, but we'll focus in the next session. Next up we have Shannon Ring, who comes to us from Careers Development. It's very important that we do look after your well-being and your health. It's actually quite paramount to us. So if you can just please join me in welcoming Shannon Ring.
And focus.
Welcome everyone. My name is Shannon Ring. I'm one of the career consultants or career coaches at CEDES. I am based in the clock tower, just for future reference. I am sitting at the back there, and I wasn't actually expecting quite so many faces, so it's fantastic to see. I'm also hearing about all of the things that you need to focus on over the next semester and moving into the rest of your degree. So it sounds like you guys have a lot to focus on. So what I'm wanting to do is to pull your focus a little bit back and kind of start looking strategically across the next couple of years and potentially after your degree. So a little bit about myself. I once was sitting where you guys were. I completed a Bachelor of Science and Bachelor of Arts here a couple of years ago. I'm not going to count. So I had to have been in a situation where I've been trying to work out what to do with my degree and what was next. Since then, I've had sort of 8+ years experience in HR working for recruitment agencies. So I have a lot of experience of being on the other side, seeing what it's like throughout the application process and what is really needed for graduates to think about at this stage and not so much at the end of your degree. Yeah. I also run a dance school during the evenings, so I also know what it's like to have a portfolio career for those who are looking at doing something a little bit different. So there's just a little bit about me. Now I am going to do something a little bit different, and I know a quick game is a good game. So I want everyone to stand up. All right, guys, I'm going to need your focus here because I don't want to talk about some other things, but I think this is important. I've got a 20 cent coin, and I'm going to flip it, and I want everyone to sit down if you think it's going to be tails. All right. It was heads. Yeah. And again, I want everyone to sit down if you think it is heads. And stay seated. Yeah. All right. It's tails. Working way down. Everyone to sit down if you think it's going to be tails again. All right. Nice. Final decision? Yep, it's heads. Everyone to sit down if you think it's going to be heads. You're just going to say sit it down. All right, and it's tails. I'm going to keep going until I've got one last left here. Everyone to sit down if you think it's tails. It's heads. All right, we've got some keen. Everyone who think it's heads, please sit down. Yeah, so if you think it's going to be tails, stay standing. Yep, and it's tails. I'm going to get this down to one person. Now, everyone sit down if you think it's going to be heads. Right, we've got some keen beans. Okay, everyone take a seat. All right. Okay, can I get your attention? The aim of the game, like I said, I actually literally thought I was going to be talking to 20 people today, not 340. So it's a bit easier to play that game when there's less of you here. The point is that sometimes you don't understand, and I was hoping to get down to one person because I've got this awesome little voucher, but it was going to take too much of my time. Yeah, I've only got 15 minutes to tell you a bit about who we are and what we can do to support you. The whole reference for the game is sometimes... it is important to be able to be, to take the most of every opportunity and to be present in order to be able to play the game and be a part of the game. You guys could have chosen to be staying at home, going to the beach, watching Netflix, but you're not. You're here and you are gaining a whole lot of information, you're getting yourself prepared, and with that preparation, once that meets opportunity, you get success. So if I just... Yeah, so success is where preparation and opportunity meet. You made the decision to come here and help get yourselves prepared so you have a greater opportunity to be successful later on. So my advice is to invest as much as you possibly can in your own preparation so that you can create your future. Yeah. So how do you prepare to create your future? You need to look, try, get support, ask questions, get involved, think and reflect. Right from the beginning of your degree, the more you do between now and the end of your degree, you increase the chances and the opportunities to be successful and build the future that you want. Not the future that your parents want, not the future that your friends think you should have, and also sometimes not necessarily the future that other people here at university think is best for you. You need to create your own future. So this degree, and I think this is something that the law faculty has really impressed upon me, because I work closely with the law faculty and also the creative arts faculty. The law degree has a fantastic reputation amongst many organisations. You have the top eight, and I know that across March you've got summer clerkships to think about, internships, etc. The top eight's fantastic. You've got a whole lot of other legal firms. You've got a whole lot of other opportunities out there where you can work in-house, where you can work in corporate, where you can work in public sector. So it is important to be able to look and find out what's out there, to try what the university provides you in terms of support and opportunity, to ask for support, because you have plenty of it here, certainly at CDES, and I also know that Jan Blair works down in the law faculty, so you have a lot of support. Getting involved with everything that we prepare, and I'm about to quickly talk you through some of the things that we do, provide you guys. Think and reflect as you take your journey. Is this the right journey? Maybe opportunities don't work out as you thought they would, and so, okay, great, what are my options now? Who can support me in that? And that's certainly something that myself, CDS, and our Jan player are really keen to do. If you actually go see a career consultant outside of university, you're probably looking at $100 to $150 plus per hour just to meet and talk this through. You guys have this access for free. I was at university for 4.5 years, didn't even know CDS existed. If I had known, I wouldn't have studied biology, geography, and Spanish. Yeah, I would be understanding that career coaching and inspiring young people and inspiring people who are starting out on a new part of their journey is what I'm really passionate about. So that's why I'm really excited to talk to you guys today. So, how can we support you? So, got summer clerkships coming up. So we have Law Distribution Week, distributing law materials down at the law faculty. We've got workshops, I think on the 3rd and the 4th with Jan Blair, to look at CVs and applications. We also have one-on-one appointments for essential kind of career decisions that you're trying to make, any assistance that you're required with regards to your careers. We also run a Finding Your Career Pathway workshop, which looks at pulling in your values, the types of jobs and industries you'd be interested in, and it just gives you that sort of initial support if you're starting to look at different opportunities. Networking and building relationships, I couldn't stress this enough. We try and provide you with as many opportunities as possible so you can build relationships with law firms, with employers. We have recruitment events, we have expos. We've got a law expo in March. Make the most of it. Your opportunity to get in front of those employers outside of university, it is extremely hard, so make the most of it now. Yeah, you might not be looking for a job now, that's fine. But maybe that same person is going to be the person who's interviewing you in 2 years' time, and they remember meeting you and were impressed with you. Yeah. So relationship building through networking is extremely important. There's a whole lot of other expos and events that might be more related to your conjoint degree. It is really good to understand what is out there so that you can create, like I said, create your future. What else have we got here? We provide information around internships and graduate opportunities on our CDS website. You have your own personal My CDS portal, and on there you can access booking one-on-one opportunities with us or appointments. Look at workshops, what events are coming up, what jobs, what internships and clerkships are out there, which I know is also posted on the law website, which comes through us. And it's also, we're posting a whole lot of other types of jobs as well. So really good to keep your eyes and ears open. We also have a daily drop-in where you can come up for 5 minutes, bring your CV, LinkedIn profile, cover letter, law application, and we can give you some feedback. So this is all free, and I seriously cannot advise that you guys make the most of it. Last but not least, I know that the journey for myself at university and for everyone else here, there's a lot to think of, there's a lot to take on, there's a lot to study for, there's competition for certain positions, so there can be an additional stress. So what I would love to impress on you guys is to be positive. Increase your options, yeah? If you, at such an early stage, and we say this to every single faculty, if you narrow your opportunities now, and that doesn't, for whatever reason, happen, then you need to go back to the beginning of your career journey again. If you increase your options, and obviously with a conjoint, you have increased options, also increase your knowledge as to what else is out there, then your ability to be adaptable and resilient increases. Yeah? Challenge equals opportunity. I'm sure you guys have heard that. Any challenge that you're presented with, any perceived failure, anything that doesn't seem to work out as you had intended is an opportunity. And when you have that frame of mind, anything's possible. Good health, I know that someone's going to be talking about well-being next, so I'll leave that up to them. A sense of humour, and you have all the support here at university, so please do make the most of it. Yeah. So just quickly, this is what our the CDS website looks like. If you don't take anything from this talk, just do take that website, have a look. You've got all of our information and opportunities there. And you log in, you all have a personal MyCDS portal, and on there it's got everything that you can build for yourself on there. If you have any questions, you're welcome to come and chat to me afterwards. Hopefully I'll see more of you guys across your journey to creating your own future. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob, everyone. Great. Just a bit, you know, just a bit of unco people over here. It's going like that, but yeah, we'll work on it. Next up, we have Kylie Ryan, who is a wellbeing educator, also from Careers Development and Employment Services. Cycle's just testing. She's not from there, actually, and she will explain where she's actually from.
We're just tricking. Hey, everyone, how's it going? You're nearly there. I'm going to let you eat soon, because I'm starving as well. So I am the wellbeing educator for the entire university. So it's just me and 35,000 students, and I'm responsible for you not going crazy, pretty much, is my job. So today I'm going to talk to you a bit about skills that you can employ to look after your wellbeing over the next, not just whilst you're at university, but once you become a lawyer, which is one of the highest stress positions that you can go into. Yay you! Exciting, isn't it? You can't wait. So glad you got into second year. So, what we know about mental illness in a university setting, okay? We know that 75% of people who experience some form of mental illness will do so before the age of 25. Okay? So, after that, you go on the upwards. Okay, 1 in 4 people will experience mental illness in their lifetime. So, how many of you are here? What's a quarter of that? A lot, that's what it is. I did a social work degree, not a maths degree. So there's a lot, okay? So I know in business tomorrow I've got 2,000 students, 500 of them are gonna experience mental illness at some point. Okay, it's a lot. But there's some more good news for you. If you come to university, you're 5 times more likely than the general population. Yay! Okay, so that's why my role is really important and why we start employing some of these skills early on. So the main 3 referrals we get through our health and counselling service, 1 is anxiety, 2 is depression, and 3 are relationship issues. Okay, what some of you don't know, because we don't always tell you, is that you have 6 free sessions with a psychologist that you've already paid for every year. I know, imagine. So, who knows where Munchie Mart is? Who doesn't know where Munchie Mart is? Munchie Mart, bookstore. You all know where the bookstore is? Munchie Mart is behind the bookstore. Health and counselling is upstairs from there. Okay, I'm going to show you the website and where you can enrol online so that it's easy to use our services if you need to. The other thing I want to point out to you is there's a big difference between someone who's very stressed and experiences anxiety and someone who experiences clinical depression. Okay, that's what a brain looks like when it's clinically depressed. It is extremely hard to function in an academic environment with clinical depression. People suffering from clinical depression don't always know they're in that space, which is why it's important for you to look out for each other. If you have a friend who's struggling on a day-to-day basis, they're not making it to lectures and tutorials, and they can't put a plan in place to get themselves back up again, that's when they need to come and see us ASAP. Okay, because we need to get a few more lights ticking on in that brain so that they can get back to their best again and perform academically really well within the law school. This is what we're trying to stop happening. Okay, sometimes when things are really stressful, this is what we feel like doing. Okay, we sometimes stop turning up for things. We isolate ourselves from our friends. If you can see that happening with someone in your courses or who you're close with, please again get them through to the support services so we can help them move through that. You will probably get to this point at some time this year. Okay, it's really important that you personally know for you what your red flags are, that you are not doing so well and you're starting to get really stressed out. Okay, have a really quick talk to the person next to you or think in your head, what are your red flags that things are about to turn to custard? A quick chat. Alrighty. Okay, coming back to here. Would anyone like to share what their red flags are? I'm going to be one of those people who puts you on the spot and points at you if you don't. Where's all the mature students when you need them? I was one of them too. Okay, what's someone's red flags? How do you know when things aren't going so well? Yep.
I stopped going to classes.
Yep, stop turning up to classes.
Alcohol.
Yep. Increasing alcohol intake. Yep. Anyone not sleep? Hands up if you are not going to sleep or waking up and staying awake for 3 hours in the middle of the night kind of person. Anyone sleep a lot? Okay, anyone forget to eat when they're highly stressed out? Yep. Does anyone eat a lot when they're stressed out? Okay, so as you can see, the biggest red flag I can give you is that they tend to be at opposite ends of the spectrum. Everyone copes really differently with stress, but your red flags tend to be either you're not sleeping or you're sleeping all the time. You're not eating, you're eating all the time. You're not talking to anyone, you're talking to everyone and doing everything with everyone. Okay, so they tend to be at opposite ends of the spectrum. So keep an eye on you. What are they for you? If you know it now, let your friend know what they are. If you don't know what yours are, ask your mother. I'm sure she'll tell you. Okay, but jot them down on a piece of paper. If they start coming up, then it's time to get some help. Right, so what can we do so we don't get to that point in the first place? We nearly went to the next slide. This is the bubble of love. Okay, we now have a whole website and you're about to get a program rolled out to all of you as law students this year on a weekly basis. So when your wellbeing little emails come out from your student support advisors, please open them up and have a quick look at some of the skills you can do that week. Okay, they will help with your academic performance if you're functioning really well mentally. You are going to get to this point. Okay, students will quite often say to me, why can't the university just not give us all the assignments at the same time and stop stressing us out? We can't do that, I'm sorry. And sometimes it's outside of our control. And unfortunately, life's a wonderful thing and it probably hasn't even started messing with some of you yet. Okay, and it's gonna get to that point. Start doing some of these things now and hopefully it will reduce that stress somewhat. So number one, connecting with other people. Okay, this is one of the five ways to well-being. The reason it's important is that when we connect with other people, we produce all sorts of happy hormones in our brain. Okay, when we're suffering from anxiety or depression or really stressed out, we need those happy hormones to pick us up a bit. Okay, so you've got 1 minute to turn around to the person behind you. I know, scary. You've never talked to them before, have you? And say hello and introduce yourself by name. Go.
Hi.
are all... It's too exciting. Okay, coming back to here. Some of you have got really long names. Okay, you are all in this together, guys. You are all going to be experiencing the same amount of stress. Help each other out and get to know each other. If you're a person who finds it hard to connect with other people and have a bit of social anxiety, we have two wellbeing groups that run through the health and counselling. I'll show you how to log into those, and they'll work on skills for you to start connecting with other people and make it a bit easier. Okay, we've also got over 250 clubs and societies that you can link into. So give those a go. The other one is giving back. Now we're going to have a whole give back week in Lua, where we look at nice things we can do to other people, because it makes us feel happy inside when we do nice things for other people. Okay, so that week is about week 5, so keep an eye out for that one. Staying active. Okay, this is another really quick way to get those hormones released that you need if you're not doing so well. Okay, from a well-being perspective, it's 15 to 20 minutes a day of anything you are going to do consistently. Okay, that's walking to Britomart and back, or across up that big hill of the Domain, and back again. Okay, try and put it into your day, it will make a huge difference. This is really important, and I'm going to shoot through it. This is about sleep. Okay, any of you who have had children, or had been in a house where there are children who wake you up, you will know that not sleeping has a huge impact on your well-being. Okay, you need 7 to 8 hours sleep a night to go through the sleep stages you need to function and perform academically at your best. 5% of the population can win on 4 hours sleep. Any of those people around, 4 hour sleepers? You have a genetic abnormality, well done. Okay, the rest of us need our 7 to 8 hours sleep. There are a few things that are going to stop you getting the sleep you need. Okay, you should be going to sleep what time at night? Hands up. What time should you go to sleep at night? 10? Okay, it's 10:30 is the ideal time to be falling asleep. Okay, 10:30 is the ideal time to be going to sleep. That means you're going to go through the right sleep stages. However, you will not be going to sleep at 10:30 if you are looking at any light. Okay, your brain needs to produce melatonin to go to sleep. Even with those fancy lights that they say, hey, download this, it'll take away the blue light, they don't work. Okay, your brain needs to not look at light for an hour before it goes to sleep, otherwise you won't be able to go to sleep. Okay, caffeine is the other thing. I'm like the joy police with sleep. So caffeine, guys, if we keep talking, we're not going to get through it, sorry. Okay, caffeine, ideally one a day, not after 2 p.m. Alcohol? None at all. Okay, I know that you guys are not going to do this all the time. I get paid to do this and I don't do it all the time. But if you are starting to get really stressed out, this is the number one thing you can do to make life a little bit better for yourself. Try and get your sleep in line, cut back on your caffeine, your alcohol and your devices. Get your 7 to 8 hours sleep and you'll be feeling a lot better the next day. The other thing during study time when you're cramming, they recently did a study at Harvard where they had two groups of students, one who crammed till 3 a.m. in the morning before their exam, the others who got their 7 to 8 hours sleep. The ones who got their 7 to 8 hours sleep had 20 times the memory recall in their exam the next day. 20 times, that's huge. Okay, so start thinking about those things when you're stressed out. Right. Money. There's not many rich students around. Our main resource for money within the university is AUSA if things aren't going so well, or come and see our psychologists and they can do some financial counselling with you. Okay, I won't have much time to go over the rest of that today, sorry. Take notice. This is about mindfulness. Hands up if you've heard of mindfulness. Okay, overseas in universities, they roll this out on a daily basis. They do it before exam times. The best app that I've found for students, A, because it's free and because it's designed for you, is called Smiling Minds. Okay, you can download it 5 minutes a day. When they did a recent research study, it improved GPA by one whole mark. The reason for that is that it grows the part of your brain that does emotional control and memory. So for students, it's well worth considering. There is a mindfulness group through health and counselling that you can enrol in that's particularly around improving academic performance. Okay, if you Google health and counselling, Auckland University, you will see the wellbeing groups there and you can enrol online. Keep learning. This is a little bit about what you're talking about in the past one. Sometimes things don't go to plan. It's not necessarily the end of the world. Okay, there are other options that you can look at career-wise. There are other pathways that you can take which will still mean you have the same career, just not necessarily how you're expecting it to happen. Okay, so keep talking to people, don't give up just when it hits the first speed bump and you don't quite get the mark that you needed. Okay, go and seek the support services for that. The last one really quickly, what you put into your body is going to make a huge difference to how well your brain learns. Okay, we've got a whole lot of resources online. We also have mindful eating groups through health and counselling that are worth looking at as well if this is an issue for you. Okay, so how do you access all of this? You just go www.aucklandac.nz/wellbeing. It's all going to be on there. It's there right now, waiting for you to look at it. You'll also get weekly emails on this, and also the Law Facebook page will provide a link for you through to the wellbeing pages. Alrighty, so sorry it was so quick, but have a nice life. And please use us at Health and Counselling if you need us.
Thank you, Kylie. And I'd just like to invite our student leaders, if we could just please make your way to the front, representatives from AULCS, Pilsa, as well as Talako Ture, please, if we can just make our way to the front.
Hi everyone, my name's Jason and I am the AULSS president for 2017. For those of you that don't know what AULSS is, it basically stands for the Auckland University Law Student Society. We basically take care of all the fun things at university, like the ball, law steins, the garden party, and of course, law camp. Instead of going through what AULSS does, which I'm sure you'll find out from the rest of the year, I thought I'd just take this time quickly to talk about three things that I've picked up during university so far. So the first thing is to jump at every opportunity. Mooting, witness examination, negotiation, client interviewing, all these things, social events, there's so many things that law school has to offer, and I encourage you to jump at each every opportunity that you get. You will learn so much, you'll make new friends, and you only get one shot at the next 3 or 4 years of this degree, so make the most of it. The second thing is to use the resources that you have available to you. We have some awesome lecturers that are willing to give up their time to help you do well, so use them. I know it can be very intimidating, but honestly, once you go and break that ice, it's so easy to go up to them and talk to them about anything. Also, older students have so much to give to you, and they are itching to tell you how good they did and how well they are and what kind of person they are, so use that against them. And yeah, I encourage you to go talk to them. And the last thing is stress less. Yeah, I can't urge this enough. One grade, one test, one essay, it doesn't define who you are or shape your career. It's a stepping stone. Some of the best lawyers and judges today have, you know, been through what you're going through now. Like, they go through bumps, they have bad grades, but it's just about work ethic and it's about being a good person and, you know, getting through it. So, yeah, just quickly, those are the three things. I know it sounds like a bit of a jumble here, but the important thing is just to find balance. I think if you have balance in your life, with work, with study, with friends, with fun, that's when you are able to do the best because you have a clear headspace. Just some quick information on camp. I know a lot of you are going to be walking down to law school to sign up, probably running down to sign up. So what you need to know is that before you get to law school, there's an open road, right? So there's cars. There are a lot of cars, and cars are fast, so be careful. Don't push each other. And lastly, if you guys have any questions about anything, you know, want to talk about life or something like that, feel free to come up to me, chat to me whenever, email me, message me. I'll be around. Thanks, guys.
Kia ora koutou, ka mihi kia koutou katoa. Congrats again on getting into part two. My name's Alex. I'm the Tūmaki Tāne, or male co-president of Te Raku Tere. So we're the student whānau for us Māori law students here at the University of Auckland. So basically what we do is we kind of provide a whānau away from your own whānau to just hang out. It's really good for your spiritual well-being as well. It makes you feel comfortable at law school, makes you feel like you actually belong. We do trips and stuff that if you've been to the orientations and that, you would have already heard about. But feel free, if you have any questions, feel free to come up to myself or any of the other members. Also, just a quick note, we're going to be having a opening for our new room, Te Ako. So that's going to be, it's likely to be on Monday in the morning at about 6 o'clock in the building 801, and the room's 410, I think. So up on level 4, so you're more than welcome to come to that, whether you identify as Māori or not. If you have any questions or anything, I'll go down to law school after this and you can come up and have a chat.
Tālo whālava, everyone. My name is Robin Lisatele. I am the female co-president for the Pacific Island Law Students Association. And we're also here for our Pacific students. If you want to know more about us, we are located just across from the Māori Association. Feel free to come around. We're really friendly. I'm really tired. We just got back from camp. But we're really excited. Congratulations again. It's a big achievement to just come this far. So yeah, well done. And welcome.
Kia ora, everyone. My name is Jade. This is Ella. We are the co-directors of the Equal Justice Project. Before I tell you a little bit about what we do, I just wanted to also say congratulations on getting into part two. Such an amazing accomplishment, and I really hope that you make the most of your time here at law school. So the Equal Justice Project is a law school-based volunteer group. We have about 100 volunteers each year, and there's an application process to get in, but basically what we do is we are trying to enable equal access to justice in the community, mainly our Auckland community. We send volunteers into community law centres, we write articles, we run symposiums. There's too much to cover here right now, so please go check out our website, www.equaljusticeproject.co.nz, for more information.
Yeah, cool. Jade's pretty much said it all, but awesome to see you guys here today. This is a huge year for EJP, so we'd really love to see you all apply and get involved. We have an information session on Monday the 13th of March, where you can come along, meet our incredible executive, and just learn about what we do. The kind of students we're looking for are fun, involved, engaged. We don't care about grades at all. We just want you to come along, have a good time, and just really like give back to the Auckland legal community and enjoy doing it. It appeals a lot to like criminal law students if that's something you're interested in. It's really rewarding work, and I really encourage you to get involved and come along and meet new people. Thank you.
See you all on the 13th of March.
Kia ora everybody, my name is John Kingy. I'm one of the directors of Rainbow Law with Alex Cranston here. This is our shirt she's modelling, so please buy one. So basically what we do is advocacy events and support for our Rainbow community here at law school. It's not just for those people who identify as Rainbow, so if you're a supporter or if you want to get involved, please feel free to do so. We have an office in level 2 of building 810. This is the first year we're going to have a safe space for our queer students here at law school, so if you ever want to pop in, we'll be around there quite a bit this year, so feel free to come in, have a tea or coffee, or just hang out. We have a Facebook page, which is the primary way at the moment to get in touch with us. We also have an email, so if you're interested, let us know via our Facebook page. This year we're wanting to run a series of events, so we've got like a lecture series that we will be running with Simpson Gresson. We'll also have a series of like networking mixes with practicing lawyers who are openly queer. And we're also looking at setting up a mentoring program. So if you're a new Part 2 student and you're from our community, we're looking to match you up with a practicing lawyer who's out there right now. So that's pretty exciting. We're looking at expanding our group this year. So if you're interested in getting involved, please get in touch. And congrats on getting into Part 2. Cheers.
Hey guys, I'm Tom and this is Jasper, and we're here to talk about the review. If you guys haven't heard of the Law Review before, it's a comedy, sketch, musical, dancing sort of show that is written and put on by the law students at Sky City every year. Talent's not required, seeing as Jasper and I are standing up here, but it's a really great way to meet a whole lot of people in your second year. I know I made a whole lot of friends and it really made my life a whole lot easier, and I got a lot of notes from the older cast members, but that's just a little bonus, so...
And if you guys want more information about it, or it sounds like something you might be keen to do, you can find us on Facebook as well. We've also got a YouTube channel where you can sort of get a sample of a lot of the things we've done, which have been pretty successful. And me and Tom will both be down at law school after this if you want to have a chat. So thanks, guys.
Sweet. Cheers.
Hi, everybody. Congratulations on making it here. My name is Nausheen and I'm from the Mooting Society, so we exist to facilitate mooting at law school. If you don't know what that is, it simulates a court hearing, so it's probably the closest experience that you're going to get while you're at university to actually advocate or present an oral argument in front of a judge or appear in front of court. So we run a series of competitions throughout the year that you can take part in by joining, and a series of social events, and also we have educational resources, which include seminars to actually improve your oral advocacy skills. We're going to be down at law school, so that's where sign-ups are going to be happening at the same time as they are for AULSS. It's really easy, so there's a form, there'll be a box when you're signing up to AULSS that you can just tick and say, yes, I want to be part of the Mooting Society. The exec is also going to be down there. If you want to have a chat to us about what mooting's like or what it's about, please let us know. This year we're running a series of events called Impromptu Mooting. So if a mooting competition sounds intimidating or too hard, an impromptu moot is something that you can just rock up to with friends and get a feel for what mooting's like. It's really social and it's really enjoyable. Hope to see you all there. Thanks.
Hi, my name's Brett. I'm from a newly formed group. We're not an official society yet. We're called Not Your Average Law Students, and we are trying to build a network for mature students, so older students, which is why I'm up here. We have our first event planned for the evening that Law Camp is on, which is kind of a deliberate step on our part, because generally, I remember when Law Camp was on, I was there, no way I was going. So I figure other people in a similar boat might be coming along to our event. You can find us on Facebook. We've got plans to have social events during the year, but it's pretty unformed still. So, you know, jump in, help us, meet some people. It'll be cool.
Thanks. Oh, and congratulations.
Hello, everyone. My name is Zenas.
And this is Owen.
Hello.
Hi. We're from Veritas, which is a Christian law students fellowship, and we're part of the TSF, which is the Tertiary Students Christian Fellowship. So if you've heard of EU, OCF, engineering, CMS, they're all part of this fellowship, and we run events during the year, and we talk about what Christianity is, what faith is, and if it relates to our life or not, and we do discussions. And sometimes we do combined events, like with PILSA last year, we got to invite Chief Justice Andrew Beecroft to talk to us, and it was pretty cool.
Our first event for the year is going to be run somewhere on the campus. We haven't got a place yet. But anyway, we know that most of you, or I don't think any of you have been through a Law 101 course, and I don't think any of you guys have yet survived law school. So we want to run a course called, a forum, called a Law School 101 Survival Guide, so that you can know how to get through 101 and survive. Yeah. We'll be talking about how to deal with large quantities of work, and also how does the Christian faith relate to university and law school in general. I can confirm that Marcus Roberts will be speaking for that, who is one of the law faculty. Thank you.
Kia ora, folks. I just want to highlight a couple of things just before we wrap up. We're at the end, and thanks for laughing at my jokes. I was actually on trial. I actually might not have a job after this. Inside your packs, please, there is a Law Part 2 orientation book over here. Actually, read it. I did write some stuff in it, and it's probably the stuff that has mistakes, but it's the stuff that really counts. Don't come to our office if you haven't read it. But one last thing I want to say in just closing. There's a couple of people that we do have to acknowledge in regards to setting up today. The first is Saranjika, who obviously you guys have met, who's the manager of the Student Centre. We've also got Martina, who put together all your packs as well as the programs, contacted all our lecturers and the rest of the Student Centre team. I just want to say something in closing, if I may, especially just as we get ready to kind of head on down. Folks, I was once in your place, like everyone said before. I've been here for 10 years, 5 as a student, 5 as an actual staff member. It's hard. Law degree's hard. I'm just going to tell you guys straight up, if you guys thought that it was going to be a breeze, it's really difficult. But one thing that I guess I want you guys just to take on board is that you guys have an opportunity to build a really good culture amongst your cohort. In past years, we've been really exclusive. There have been student groups that have been really exclusive. It can be an intimidating place, but it does not hurt to say hello to your neighbour. It does not hurt to actually just let your neighbour know that, you know, if things are going bad, that you can just reach out, or just even a smile. You'll be amazed at how much a smile can actually go far. And it can actually even end up in a relationship. But as but as the figures show, we've got a man drought down at the law school. And also want to thank Rainbow Law as well for mixing up the numbers. But it does, okay, folks, at the end of the day, I just want you guys to know. Look, I'm just want to support Veritas, but I just want to say this. Yeah, reach out to your student next to you. Make sure that you guys journey together. I once had a principal at high school before I got kicked out. And there's one thing that he said was this before I gave him the middle finger. He goes, if you go to the top, make sure that you take somebody with you. Sitting next to you are the very people that are going to go to the top. And I don't mean to be all preachy and stuff like that, but I just want to let you guys know, look, love your neighbor as you love yourself, and just make sure that each and every one of you are okay. You have the opportunity to create an awesome culture going forward. Laugh at it now, but when you're actually struggling, we'll be the ones who are actually picking up the pieces. You guys have been absolutely awesome. I wish you guys all the best. Take care of one another.